Hello and welcome back to the SWN podcast, my first recorded interview in 3.5 months. Quite a bit's changed in that time. Of course, things like CM Punk has went from the greatest things in sliced bread to enemy of the state. There's been a pay-per-view in, oh, sorry, premium live event in the UK for WWE. And, had a child. Well, I didn't. I did very little work when it came to having a child. It was mostly Kelly who did it. I've just been the one that's been holding them since. But we're back-ish for a 4.5 season, a nice little condensed season, and I had to get someone back for the first time. We're finally doing a Halloween on Halloween episode for our annual catch up. Welcome back to the show, Harmony Skye.
Thank you. I've been waiting for the Halloween episode for the past 2 years, but
No,
I'm here for it.
we always just miss it. We always just miss it by like a week or yeah, it literally has been a week either side, I think, in
A
previous
week,
years.
aye.
And this one's actually going out on the 31st. I don't think it's not going to be the first episode of this 4.5 run. I think we've got a chat with Luke and Sharp next week, and it's for Dane spotting, so it's a bit more time sensitive. But this is going out on Halloween, so we're in the spirit. You've got your witch's hat on, which is
Of
going to
course.
mean it's going to be lost on people in the audio feed. But I've got a nice little spider web shirt on because I panicked and realized today that I don't have anything Halloween related wear. So I thought, all right, I've got a shirt, that'll do. That was £6.90 Primark. Excellent. Yeah, it's been a year. So we'll go a little bit through what you've done. We won't go through everything, all the nooks and crannies, but we'll just pick and choose bits as we go. But I think the most important question is just how's it going? Are you well?
Good. I'm well. I've been kind of, I spent some time off training not that long ago, so I've been trying to get back into it, but slowly. So that's gone well. So just trying to work myself back up to where I was before, like COVID and stuff. Wait a minute.
Yeah, I've seen you. You've had a bit of run of a little bit of bad luck as well. Earlier in the year, I was seeing in the run up to FPWA's showcase show. But we'll wind back to last time we spoke, which would have been about October, end of August, October last year. I think there was a show just about to come up that we kind of half previewed because it was going to happen before the episode actually went through. Which I didn't write down because that would have been really handy. I've just got my first match on my notes here is November, which was Respect Pro, when you were against a team with Emily Hayden, the new tag team. What was it called again? It was Peace Love
Beach
and
Love and
Harmony.
Harmony, which was the best name that I wish I could take credit for.
Emily has a very unique way of trying of squeezing in Beach to anything.
Anything.
I mean, I think the only reason I got her in for the finale for the quiz was because I went, right, I need you into this finale because you're going to be Queen's Beach, and she was like, sold.
Done.
That was all it took, which is quite nice and fine when a guest just goes, right, that's fine, yeah, you convinced me. I can't argue with Queen's Beach, and here we are. So it was against Ruby Roberts and Ellie Armstrong, so a lot of new faces that you've
Yes.
been come into contact with. So what was it like? So last time we spoke, you were just ICW, just on WWE Network. A couple shows here and there, but what was it like kind of properly bursting out into a new promotion like Respect?
Yeah, it was great because that was one of my first kind of like family friendly shows. I didn't really come like what to expect. It was great because my parents were there and like my mum's cousin and stuff was there. But getting to plan that match, especially with a couple of women like Ellie Armstrong and stuff, was really, really good to have like different inputs with different people who had been training at a bunch of different times. And it was great just getting to like plan things with new people. It was just like the new a whole new experience. Like I didn't even know what words to use. But then during the match, I did give Ellie Armstrong a real headbutt, which I didn't mean. And it hurt me, so I just didn't even ken what it would have done to her. And she was going to answer it, and I was like, I'm so sorry, I didn't mean that. She's like, it's fine. She's like, I didn't care. And I was like, I slapped on the heathen on.
It's a good mix of people there. Like Emily's just she's been around for a long time now. She's more the veteran stage of these things. Ruby Roberts, of course, not just she's had this remarkable transformation, but she's got a little bit more of an experience, because of course she's grew up with Bobby Roberts and what have you. And then you've got Ellie, who's brand new, debuted last year, I think it was, on the WWE Network in front of no people.
Of course.
So she's still got to kind of, she's still finding her feet with crowds as well. So it's a nice little mix. So you're quite happy with other than like smashing your head against Ellie Armstrong's face. But other than that, quite happy with it.
Very happy. Yes. I got to also say like the meet and greet, which was my first time doing like a proper meet and greet. It was really weird. Because it was me and it was DCT, and I can't remember who else was there. And I just remember DCT like being like, oh, that gear's really cool. And I was like, oh my god, I've seen him on that WWE Network, and I'd never met him before. And I went to get a picture with my dad, and he was just in the background there, and I was like, oh my god, photobombed. But and it was good. It was like that 3 weeks. I think it was like 3 weeks, and that's when I had like 3 matches. It was like that. Then it was Pro 2, and I had ICW, and that was just like, it was like kind of like a glimpse into what the future could look like. And it was really overwhelming, but it was really fun because they were all against completely different people. So that was like interesting and good, and it's a bunch of whole different experiences. So like we were all on different like experience levels. A new company, so that was really, really fun.
Good. Turn my headphones a sec. I can barely hear you. It's probably my stuff as well. So good to be back. So a lot of experiences. So you got that. I got Pro 2 Battle of the Belts for the mm-hmm. vacant at the time to become the first Pro 2 Bells champion. But back to the meet and greets for a second. Then so when you were growing up watching or going to these shows, and you were the meter. Mm-hmm. It was just a bit mind blowing seeing all these people coming to meet you and wanting to get a picture with you and little girls and boys wanting to get wee autographs and stuff like that. Was that kind of like a bit of a celebrity?
That was just really, really weird because I was like, oh, I'm going to be on like some mum's phone or some dad's phone, and like, oh, they met the wrestlers. And then, especially when it was like wee lassies that would kind of come up, and they're like, oh, like, I think it was one this year, which was the CPW one. The lassie was like, oh my god, I loved you so much, and I loved your gear, and like your hair and stuff, and it's things like that where you're like, oh my god, that's really weird, because they're looking at me as if I'm some like big like superhero kind of thing. So it's like just a weird thing to kind of digest, especially in like the early stages of your career. It's like, just, you're not really going to get used to it.
Even now for me, I'm 32 and I'm still meeting these wrestlers. I'm like, oh my god, you guys are doing a thing that I would like 12 year old me was watching and going, I wish I could do that. 18, I decided it wasn't happening, but at least 12, I was like, yes, that's the coolest thing ever. I want to be that. And even now, I'm meeting, I'm just a really shy person anyway, but meeting wrestlers, I'm trying to force myself to get pictures of wrestlers again to try and build that up. So even the most recent show I went to, it was up in Viruri, and I got a picture with Omar Muhammad, and I've spoke to Omar countless times over Instagram, and he's helped me out on the podcast. He's helped me out. He took my phone during Aberdeen Anarchy because I asked him to. I was like, if you're up for it. I still hadn't actually spoken to him face to face at any point in this, and then I finally met him in Viruri, and even I was still a little bit confused and starstruck and just not knowing how to speak to people in general in real life. It's very weird. And like I say, at 32, I mean, yourself, you're still a teenager, late teens?
Mm, 18.
Still 18, that's fine. God, the first time I spoke to you, you were 16. Now remembering, I felt 16. Extremely old because I asked you what your first memory was, and I was like, oh my god,
I was like, WrestleMania.
No, I'm getting flashbacks. I was speaking to Kelly about that. I was like, I'm speaking to these people that, like, oh, big fan of Jeff Hardy. I'm, oh yeah, I remember back in the day, and his feud with CM Punk. I was like, god, no. No. That's too recent. So you're meeting wrestlers is still the coolest thing at this age, and now you're the other side of things. My only kind of real experience of it the other way, and at the show Rock and Wrestle, I was transporting folk. Warwick was up in Inverness and did a speech at a school, and it was Ricochet, weirdly enough, Ricochet, Joey Legend, and a couple of wrestlers who are no longer able to be put on the internet without being cancelled. And all these kids were getting their autographs, and they started running up to us. And we were like, "Why? Why are you running at us? We're just driving folk." And they were asking for autographs. And I was like, "Okay, cool. I'll just write my name. Ah, cool. Why not? This is not the one that's at the back of my debit card, so it's fine. You're not going to defraud me at any point." But it's a very weird experience, and especially someone as young as yourself, it's like, "Oh, this could be overwhelming very quickly." So yeah, Pro 2, first time at a championship, amazing. I've seen some of the shows on that they've put online, and it seems like a really good crowd, really rabid crowd. Yeah. And so what was it like getting in about Pro 2?
It's like a kids version of ICW. You've got your hardcore ICW fans, it's like hardcore Pro 2 fans. And it was just like nice. It was almost like Bouncy Castle place that I'd never been to before.
Oh, is this the Bouncy Station one?
My dad surprised me to come in with like my papa and my uncles and that, so I didn't care that they were gone. So I just went Ashley Vega, obviously she'd love a wee shout out, you know her. I was dressing her, and we also had Rosé as well, which that was really good, but because Ruby Roberts does the ring there, we were so stressed because the ring was taking a wee bit longer than we thought. So she was trying to get all that done while coming back and talking about the match and then going back. So I wouldn't even want to imagine what her he'd been going through that day. Like, she would have been stressed the match. But we were in the first half, so that's why we were a bit stressed. But then we just kind of like went through like the basics kind of things. Like, right, you just put your stuff in here and we'll figure out the best for you. We'll do that. It was quite good. It was really good. I liked it because it was like dark, so it's like when you walked through, it's like the light was just shining onto the ring, which was really interesting, and I liked that aspect of it.
So again, something very different then, because again, you're only just over a year at this point, if that in your journey, and you're getting thrown in the deep end, going right, okay, you got kind of put together the match, and then you got to fit in around someone else who's of course really busy themselves. So. It's definitely new. And speaking of crowd, you're saying the ICW crowd and like a family ICW crowd. Community Pro, it has a reputation, and I'm going to assume it is Govan, because Govan is the most terrifying crowd I've ever witnessed on YouTube, because it is literally children on sugar and just bad news in general. So you're going into there, and Govan crowd, they seem to be able to pick apart any insecurity that if you come in with, they will find it and they will take it and kill you. So Pro 2 being your kind of family / ICW light crowd, what was it like with Community Pro instead then? How was that experience?
That was, I'd probably say, one of the best shows that I've worked on. It was like a birthday party, so we had all these kids kind of round the table. I'm going to take this off because I can't be bothered. But we had all these kids round the table, kind of at the ring, and I have the best story. I think I've actually told this one before. But before I got to Community Pro. So Ross Hunter was picking me up because he was also on the show, and we were going to drive through and meet Calvin Jr. because I know what his face looks like, and while we were on the way, we were slowing down in traffic. Traffic's kind of backed up at this, like, the road we're on is called the Stan and Stane Road, and it's in Kirkcaldy, and it's a really, really busy road. And then all of a sudden, we just feel this massive thing coming to the back of us, and we got run off the road. So we got in a car crash before the show, and his car got written off, and yeah, we still made it. And I think, choose my true passion. I got in a car crash before. I've got a picture of it. Let me find a picture for it. Just to show you how bad the people that are listening to it kind of really see what I'm talking about. But it was so much more worse than I'm making it out to be.
You're being quite, wow, okay, yeah, that's a little bit of damage. It's just a little bit. So
his mum had to drive us up to meet Mr. Talon Jr. So we could just go to the show. But that was kind of like the only thing we're hanging about. We're like, oh god, like as soon as we got in it, we're like, have to text David, just let him kind of go be a wee bit late. Like, that's just not a normal thing to think when you've got in a car crash. It's kind of me like, oh, am I alright? but no, they were like, oh, I have to make sure we're not late.
It's one of those things that you can have your adrenaline run, rush you, and then as soon as the match is over, you'll be like, oh, I'm bleeding in the back of my head. Oh, I broke something. And I just didn't know because I was so heavily invested in getting to the wrestling. That is dedication. I mean, if I had a car crash, I'd write off my day. I'd be like, nope, that's an omen.
Davey was really, really good with it because they had a medic there. So as soon as we kind of got done, and also before, they were like, right to the medic, just make sure that you're all right. And I was fine at the time. My neck and all was really scary afterwards, but I didn't feel it until like a couple of days after. So I was completely fine wrestling. And that was one of my favourite matches I've done. So
you don't do things by halves here because you mentioned the car crash, of course, which is quite a big thing. And then just on the run-up to FPWA Showcase show, you sprained your ankle.
Yeah.
So does your body just not want you to wrestle? Is there a constant battle between your body and your brain that's just like, I want to wrestle, and your body goes, no, no.
Because I'd also injured my shoulder a couple of years ago, which is like so sore. And I've been like physically long, but it's just no getting better. But honestly, I feel like I've got the body like a deceased person. It's just like, not even like, oh, I've got a body like a 6-year-old that's just like done. There's like nothing here anymore.
So all the nerve ends are gone. It's fine. You can't feel anything. So it's like when you get to my age, I now get up with a sound, which is not something I thought at 18 I would get up at 32 going, ah, that's my getting up noise now. It's just everything hurts. Maybe it would help if I lost weight, but who knows? Sweets taste too good. That's just the life I live. So yeah, sprained ankle then, coming into FPWA's Showcase, 6-person match. You got Marty Kellman, Zach Swift at your side, or is it going Zachary Swift? It depends who I get results from. It depends who I get results from. It's either Zach Swift or Zachary Swift at this point.
I've not actually heard Zachary Swift before, but I like it.
It's only the one source I get Zachary Swift from, so maybe it's just his little way I don't want to spoil my sources here. Their way of just having a little bit of fun. So you're against Lexi Kimbo, Brent Carter, and Beth Shorty, which that's a bit of a bruiser of a team. So yeah, you're coming in with a sprained ankle.
Yeah, it was also Lexi Kimbo that had sprained my ankle.
Oh, that was nice of them.
Maybe just try to take me a couple of weeks before. So I was going away on holiday to Amsterdam the week kind of the show. So it was the last training session before I left. And I had no idea what move it was, but I remember feeling my ankle just kind of like really, like, I didn't get it, it was just, you could feel something wrong, and I was like, oh God. And then went to Amsterdam, my foot started to swell up and all bruised and all, and I was like, well, I can't really do anything about it. And this was the holiday that I've never walked as much in my life. Like, I've gone to Van Gogh Museum, I was gone, anywhere you can think. And then I finally got back and I was like, I better just get this checked out. And I'm like, I was really kind of confident about wanting a moon boot just because I knew it was kind of keep it strapped in. So I got an x-ray and hangs and I'm like, yeah, it's kind of sprained a wee bit. I was like, oh God. So I just taped it up the most I could. I was like, anybody got any tape? The only tape they had was like stuff you put on your wrist, which isn't really tape. Just whap that on. Made the best of it.
I hear that's quite a trope, and the old wrestler's locker room is asking for tape, and you kind of tick that one off now. So, I mean, a different circumstance, but exactly. Yeah, that's right. And I think the other part of it is you never return it. You never return the favor. It's just like, no.
I didn't.
So there's a couple of wrestlers in the FPWA locker room going, she owes me some.
I think I actually stole it. I do think I actually asked for it. I think I just came. There was like a couple packets, and I was like, I'm just going to take this one. I know that we're going to miss it. I think I just stole it. I do think who it was, actually.
So if anyone's watching back footage of the FPWA Showcase show, if you've got a hold of it, and there's someone that you think usually has wrist tape but doesn't, it's probably theirs. That's the that's where we came from there. So yeah, big six person tag. Yeah, PC. 6-person tag. Match there, and that was kind of a big show for FPWA, of course. This was our first actual show, because it had a couple at the end of the year in the last year, their kind of friends and family stuff. This is the first one they were kind of getting people to pay money to see. So home turf, So a bit closer to home. It, again, was friends and family. Were they all running along?
They were all
along.
There. Dad, as usual, there. My mum was there and things. This was the first time my little cousin Riley came to see me, which she doesn't really have any interest in wrestling, but I always flip her about. So she was like, oh, we'll stay with wrestling this. I suppose that her mum just thought, we'll just take her. But that whole day was just, I was like, oh God, this is like the first like experience of really like being a promotion when, you know, they had to strip the ring down and take it somewhere, build it all. We had water for free. I was like, oh my God, we've got a budget this time. It was just like, it was great. The only, obviously, we were all kind of stressed because we had to build this ring up for a certain time, and Studio 8 had just painted all their walls, and we weren't allowed to scrape any of the floors, so we had to be so precise with everything. And I couldn't really, I felt so bad because I couldn't carry anything because of my ankle. So I was just like, right, this way, you take that upstairs. And I was like, oh my God.
Almost convenient. Convenient there that you injured your ankle before having to build the ring.
You could say that. I always seem injured for like big things, so I always find my way out, supposedly. Zach Swift had brought this slush machine, and I think it was me, it was Lexi Kimball, and I think Ashley Vega. We were at like the slush bit, just, you know, working hard, and it just wasn't working. It just went all over the floor, all over the table that they didn't want stained, that we ended up staining it. So we were sitting and we're like, oh my God. But it worked, I think. I don't know, actually. If anybody got a slush at that show, congratulations, because I have no idea if it worked.
So let me get this straight then. The ring was the big scary bit. They didn't want to screw the floor or anything like that. You were in charge of the one thing that shouldn't have done anything. And between the three years, you stained a table and possibly the floor.
Yeah.
Great.
That's why we're better at just doing wrestling rather than like anything else. Just come, show up at this time and wrestle and leave is probably the best for us.
That's not a bad way to go about it. in about all that time, of course, you did an hour podcast. It wasn't with me for once. It was with Pipe Bombshell. Mm-hmm. So I gave them a listen, because if it's Scottish wrestling, I'm probably going to give that a listen anyway, just because. You know, I don't want to go over stuff that has been discussed elsewhere. Even though if I'd listened to it, I'd probably forget most of it afterwards. I'm still going to ask you questions that I've asked you in the last two episodes that we've done. But you're talking a lot about your mental health.
Yeah.
So you did a big post in, I think it was April as well, about it, about just being so open and honest about it.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a question from Megan Christie, and she's got a bunch of questions, so we'll litter them as we go through. But on that subject, she asked, why are you such a strong advocate for mental health?
I think it's just, especially in wrestling, you know, for like Lionheart and things, I think it's important to be so open about it, because it can be so isolating at times, especially if you're like just like a solo wrestler. I get like tag teams and stuff, you've always got somebody to speak to, but if you're solo and you have travel around, it's like it's going to get lonely at some point. Also, like, we're having multiple family members, and obviously me included, having mental health problems, and kind of maybe just if you like wrestling and you're dealing with mental health problems, it's kind of always like seeing somebody that looks like you on TV, you're like, oh, like I can relate to them because I'm going through what they're going through, or or like they're kind of like me. It's just like, even if it's like one person, or if it's any like somebody at my training and they're like struggling and they're like, I have no idea. Could talk to, I feel alone in this, or just like anybody, and they could see that I've put this post and that I'm open about it, and I'm also struggling. And there's times where like I won't go to training for months, and it's just something that I have to kind of work myself back up to as well. So I think that's why I'm so open about it. I'm not really scared about talking about my mental health either. It's like, because I've went through it, so it's like I may as well talk about it. If I've got something to give advice on, then I'm
there to
share it.
Absolutely. And I think since the pandemic and everything, where people were alone for long periods of time, I mean, I was quite lucky. I worked from home, and so did my wife. So we just worked from home. So I always had someone there and had the dog and all that kind of thing. So I never, and I don't like people generally. So I'm happy being on my own. But during that pandemic time, a lot of people just got very comfortable, and for a good reason, just to be able to talk about their feelings. And it's resonated still to today, because as of recording, I think it was maybe this morning or just yesterday evening, Redfield put out a tweet about body dysmorphia and just wanted some advice. And I retweeted it because I thought it's a very good thing to put out. And there was all these wrestlers coming back with some advice and things like that. And they all had the same kind of issues as well. And they thought, well, this has worked for me. This might not work for you. And it's just such a wholesome environment now. Not to say that it may not have been 2 years ago, but certainly in the pandemic era, it has become the forefront, because all we did for a year was just go onto Twitter and spout nonsense, and there'll be the odd gem here or there. And we got some people got far too comfortable on Twitter, but others were able to kind of be a bit more open and just go, right, I'm having a crap day. Sending pictures of dogs, or I'm having a crap day because of this. Just what advice you got? So it's just a nice thing to see on Twitter. Thankfully, I'm not following or being followed by these.
Frozen, by the way. Like,
oh, have a. You're frozen at my end. So as long as you can still hear me and I can still hear you, should be okay. Welcome back to the interview process of the SWM podcast. Back. Oh, I haven't missed this bit. I mean, the last couple of ones I've done, I've been trying to talk to myself in my car, which, you know, that's the wrestler promo 101.
Like, especially when you watch it, it's like the awkward stare of somebody's being like, oh, they're frozen, and they're just silent.
I mean, thankfully I can still hear you, so it's fine. I've had past episodes where I've had to try and cut out bits and pieces, and I can't remember whose it was. It was Luke Ross, who's now going by Lucas Alexander. I had an hour and a half, and I cut out 15 minutes of cutouts and frozens and all that stuff. So as long as we can make it another, I don't know, half an hour or so without cutting out, I'm going to take that
and
as
not
a victory.
The worst.
Exactly. I've some of the folk up in Aberdeen, I don't know what it is with internet and granite. It just does not seem to compute, which is just awful. So mental health advocacy with... It's just I'm noticing, same with when I spoke to Ashley Vega last, I'm just noticing the difference of when our first episode, where at that point you hadn't done anything other than train for a bit and watch some wrestling. And I spoke to you because I went, who wants to be on? And all the guys from FWA were like, you need to speak to Harmony Skye. It's like, all right, cool. And you were timid, quite shy. You opened up a little bit towards the end, but at the end of the day, we're two strangers speaking to each other over Zoom. It's not the most conventional conversation in the world. But as the second episode went, and in this episode, I'm just noticing that you're just very expressive. You're very extrovert in comparison to previous. Have you found that time been doing more matches, training more, meeting more people, that you have become a bit more comfortable within your own skin as well?
Usually, like, I can't even like phone the doctors or anything, because like I just get so anxious about it. But it's like completely different with like meeting new wrestlers that I've never wrestled before, and because I know we're both interested in the same thing, we're working together, we have to trust each other, and like, I think it just slowly over time, or faster I guess, it's just really opened me up. Like the first time I met Ellie Armstrong was when we'd done our match. I hadn't really spoken to her before. But I was like, hiya, and she's like, hey, and whatever. So it's just like seeing them also being open makes me feel a lot more comfortable. So I think, slowly over time, especially also just growing up as well. Like I was starting it when I was kind of 16, 17, so I'm only 18 now, but now that I've kind of grown up as well, it's kind of helping me be more out there.
One of those things where you when you're 16, you can't really go out after the show. You can't go for a couple drinks or anything like that because it'll feel weird. But now you're 18, I suppose you can just go, right, where are we going after the show? If you're staying somewhere overnight, you're like, oh, I could go out for a drink or two and socialize and things like that. I don't know. I mean, it's at 18, I still barely went outside, so I don't know what other people's experiences are for that.
I didn't actually drink any alcohol. I'm quite good like that. I got drunk once when I was like 13. Sorry, but I've never drank since. So sure.
Well, I mean, there's time to change that, but so since 13 you've been straight edge, is that?
Yeah.
Is it just because of that bad experience, or just testing it, or?
No, it's like any alcohol I drink, I could taste it. I could taste the alcohol. My sister's like, it just tastes like juice. I was like, I don't know what juice you've been drinking, but anytime she's like, try this, this tastes like lemonade. I'm like, it does me. So she's trying her hardest, but it's yet to work.
I get that, because I keep saying every time that I like things like Brewtune beer, because it doesn't taste like beer. It just tastes like juice. It does just taste like juice. It has a little bit of a beery aftertaste, maybe, but I like my alcohol to not taste like alcohol, if I can help it. So also, I'm more of a vodka kind of person, and if I'm feeling a bit. It's weird though, because I'm more vodka person, but the ones that don't taste like vodka are like your more expensive ones. So why are you paying more to not get the taste of it at the same time? So
I've had a couple like wee green frogs, but I like them when it's got loads of ice in it, because it's really watered down. But even still then, I just didn't drink them, because I'm like, oh, well, I could taste it. I take shots of that. If you give me a shot, I'll probably take it, because it's like quick.
Mm-hmm.
You just chuck it. But a whole drink, nah.
Well, I mean, who knows when this episode comes out? Who knows when we do our catch-up next year? It could be all different. It could be
I could be an alcoholic.
It could. Fingers crossed, not. Touch wood and all that kind of stuff. But you never know. It could just be next year we'll be celebrating Halloween, just getting absolutely trashed on a Zoom call. And we'll just, who knows, probably an episode I won't be able to put out, because apparently when I start, I know for a fact, when I start drinking, I have like three beers, and I become a cowboy, and I'll just shoot on everyone I don't like. And it hasn't ended badly so far, but I think it's just because people haven't listened to me being interviewed. But I think I've gotten away with it. But it's not. I've had some experiences in wrestling, and three beers, and I'll tell you all about them. And the good, the bad, and the... hashtag speaking out. Right. Okay. So moving on from that point. So I've got a little bit of a break between July and September for matches. So I don't know if you had anything in between there and Fair City Wrestling.
Probably not.
Okay. So is that just more of a case of just, were you having a little bit of just a bit of a downtime? Was it a little bit of case?
I think it's just kind of me kind of coming back. But I've been, because I gained a little bit of weight and stuff, so it's like I've just kind of tried to be working on myself. I've not been as worried about, because at the start of the year I was like, I want at least double of the matches I've done last year. But at this point I was kind of like, as long I just need to focus on myself and get myself back to a point where I'm like, I'll be able to do all these matches and be confident in every single one of them. And so just any match that I was kind of getting this year, I was happy, because it's like a new experience, new company. I was just kind of taking whatever. So I wasn't too like sad or anything. I wasn't getting all these matches.
I suppose when you're saying that you did gain a bit of weight, which obviously natural thing, there's nobody better that you could probably go to for who can take that and make sure that your wrestling is up to par with it than Andy Wilde. I suppose that's a guy who did it, who went from quite a lean frame to this kind of bulldozer frame, is be able to still keep up with his technical or even his speed and that. So was he a guy that you kind of course you're there at FPW anyway, but was he a guy that kind of tried to get advice on how to adapt a little bit to a new figure?
Yeah, it was kind of like even just simplifying things for me. Like I was always, the most thing I was anxious about was always the warm-ups. I was scared in case I wouldn't be able to do these again, like what I used to be able to do when I was 16, which shows that I was only 16 then, but it's still that mentality you have, like I used to be able to do this without even breaking a sweat. So it's kind of like, it was like, even if you could, because at times I wouldn't go, because I was just so nervous about kind of going and not being able to complete a full warm-up. It was like, even if you like go on the treadmill, or if you do like one star jump, it like doesn't matter, because you're still getting some form of exercise and you're still coming to training. And I was like getting to a point I was kind of sitting on kind of some things, which I still don't know, but it's like even if you just like do what you can, or just do what you want to, or do what you feel comfortable with, which kind of made me feel a bit better. about being there. I think you always think somebody's going to look at you or whatever, but nobody cares. They're all there for the same reason. We're all different weight sizes. We've all got different... not everybody's going to be able to do everything. And I think that's one thing that I kind of have to take in and realise that I'm not going to be able to do absolutely everything, or I'm not going to be able to do what I could do when I was 16. So just kind of like getting back in it, which I'm still kind of doing. Like I haven't been for like 2 weeks, but I just could like things like sleeping and things have literally been taking over my life, like waking up at like 6 p.m. and stuff. So that's sorted now. So now it's just kind of getting back in, even if it's like slowly back on the treadmill, like you said, back then wee bits and bobs. And I think just kind of easing back into it was a really comfortable thing for me.
It's great that you've got a school that just seems to be such a positive experience. And like you're saying, that there is everyone. Of course, you got Lexi Kimball, who's very small, very lean, and then you got guys like Craig Berry, John Kerr, who are big boys, big lads. And you got Caleb Valhalla, who is an Adonis of a man. And you've got all that mixed in there. And then, like we're saying, we've got Andy Wilde, you've got Omar, and we've got Omar's did. He's now one of us. We took him up northeast. But we've also got like Johnny Lyons, of course, who's now in better shape than he was when I saw him start wrestling in 2013, which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Not be a thing. So it sounds everything I've heard about FWA, I've never heard a bad thing about it. It seems like a really good experience. Everyone seems to be supporting each other. At least on the internet. I don't know what it's like in group chats or what have you, or in real life, but certainly outwardly, everyone seems to like each other.
Yes.
So FBWA then. So no, already mentioned them too many times. FCW, Fair City Wrestling, up in Perth, down in Perth. I'm at the top here. So that was about just over a month ago. Yes. I'm getting confused with dates now, and it's been a long time, people. It's been a long time since I've had to do this. So yeah, just over a month ago, FCW, Fair City Wrestling, up in Perth, against Brody Adler. It was Dundee, wasn't it? Dundee,
yes.
Oh, lucky you. Dundee is an interesting place. So against Brody Adler, again, someone who's very different from anyone else you probably would have faced at that point. Possibly as far as build and size, maybe an Emily, maybe a bit of an Ellie Armstrong, but Brody is a bit different from all of that as far as her style goes. So as far as putting together a match, she's still pretty new as well. Were you given some help, advice from like Kev Williams, or how did you put together a match with Brody?
No, we just just got straight into it. It was really, has also been like one of my favourite matches. It just came so easy. I've only had an hour or so we planned it quite quickly. We didn't have too long for a match, but just getting like it was honestly probably one of the easiest matches I've had to plan. And she was also kind of saying like she was quite new. It was also an enhancement match, and she'd never planned one of them before, which is kind of, usually you would only get one or two like big moves in it, but she was kind of also, I was like, this is kind of your match. And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. She's like, this is our match. And she was just always kind of wanting to make me look good. She didn't want to make me look bad or like weak in any sort of way. So she was like, get this move in or whatever. And I did tell him, I saw Redfield's move. I was on the sitting rope and I just kind of grabbed her there and I just jumped doing it to her doing weird. And then I told him I'd stole it and he was like, I'm going to steal that version of it. And I was like, see what I get you. A new move.
But that's the thing. I mean, it's a really good way of putting together a match, in my opinion, as someone who's never had to do it. But if she just absolutely steamrolls you and you're back the next month, nobody's going to want to care because you're like, oh, she just got battered last time. She's going to get battered this time as well. At least if you have a little bit of a shine or that, then at least next time they're like, well, maybe she'll do it this time. Maybe she'll win this time and there's a little bit of sympathy involved. So it all works out. It's all pieces to the puzzle when it comes to, again, and I say all this, if there's any wrestlers out there going that I'm wrong, I probably am. But, you know, I've never done it. The only things I've done is I did ring announcing in Dundee. That's about it for one show. One match. And that was enough for me. That'll do. That's my in-ring career done and dusted. So that rounds us up to the last match that I've got that you've had at this stage as of recording, which was FPWA's big proper debut. So you had your showcase show, which was a debut for FPWA, but this was the one at Truth Nightclub. So this has been a lot of stuff that was put out beforehand. You were recording things for like commercials kind of things. You were doing all that kind of cool stuff, and you were in a. You weren't actually booked in the match initially when it was announced. So it was Triple Threat. It was Ashley Vega, Daisy Jenkins, and Ivy. Triple Threat. And then about a week beforehand, someone popped up on the FPWA Facebook, and it was yourself. So
it was.
What was were you pushing to get into that match? What was it like putting you kind of bore your soul? you bore your soul in a video to plead to go into that match. So what was it like recording that and putting your emotion into it?
The way that I kind of went was Daisy had done this super edited promo, and Ivy's was just, I'm going to come in with a bat and batter people, and, you know, like, Ashley Vega was, oh, I'm the oldest pretty and I'm the best. And I just thought, I'm just going to press start, and I'm going to press stop, and I'm just going to let you see that whole thing. Like, I wanted it to be real, which it seems to be what people did perceive. It was kind of a bit of real life when I was really pushing to get in this match. I really, really wanted to be on the show because it's like 5 minutes to where I actually stay. So I just really, this was like the show that I wanted to be on the most. And I really had to like work hard to get on that show. But I worked as hard as I could.
Was that realism, like you're saying? You're just, as well as the stuff you've done with your mental health and being so open and honest, it just kind of followed on from that. If folk were following yourself and then seeing that promo, they're like, this is just Harmony Skye. I was about to dead name you there, and I didn't want to do that because that's not the point of this interview. Harmony Skye is just her, and she wants to get the opportunity, she wants to get the match, and even though her promos were great, I am a massive fan of Daisy Jenkins. I think I've only seen her wrestle on like WWE Network a couple times, and I'm just fascinated by her because I also interviewed her on the show, and it's just amazing. And Ashley Vega, of course, the modern day diva, and her whole mannerism online is just incredible. Much like yourself, I was when I spoke to her last, it was like, I can't believe that this is the same person I spoke to in the first episode. Like, I can't believe this is yourself, is the same person I spoke to way back 2 years ago, when we did this the first time. So it's just so much confidence. Ivy, I'm not 100% familiar with. I'll be totally honest. I see the name going about. I know she's got a bat. That's about it. So it was such a big dynamic. And then of course you got the match, wrestling it at a nightclub when you were just barely 18. So you need drinking at nightclubs, but you're smashing folk at them instead.
Well, I've been to that nightclub a couple of times. I actually went to that club on my 18th birthday because that's like the local one that everybody goes to. It is the best club ever I've ever been to.
I'll take your word for it. I'm too old for clubs. That's just there's a club in Elgin. Club is very is stretching it. It's called Joanna's, and we're very much positive that they used to do foam parties once a month, and we're positive they only did foam parties to clean the carpets. That was it, because you could lose a shoe in Joe's. It was disgusting. It always had been for the years I'd been. I haven't been since. For a very long time, because I'm 30, over 30 now, but it's just a disgusting place. But yeah, nightclubs, not for me. I like to be able to hear, and that kind of nightclubs either. So yeah, so you've been out in nightclubs, you've had quick shots, and now you're wrestling in it as well. What was it like doing the promotional stuff for it then? The filming and and all that kind of thing. So that must have been a bit weird.
Yeah, that was really fun though, because we knew obviously I think we filmed it a couple months before, and just we could get it all edited and stuff. But it was just like so professional. Then we had like a running order, like proper running order. This is who's doing this. They're taking this. They're doing this. It was great because so many of us were there. Like Caleb was there, and Johnny Lyons was there. We had loads of people there, and it was great. And we were all doing like each other's makeup and all along, and I was just getting to see how this thing was filmed. The amount of times that we had to date, because we had to get stuff to certain angles, which would obviously usually you just take a whole shoot. We had to do that this angle, and you had to do it all again for this angle, and if it didn't look good, you had to do it again. And it was just like, oh god, this is what it's actually like to like film like something proper. But it was really fun though. I had to take like for Kimbo's like elbow drop like 6 times. For it to be shown in like 3 things, but it's fine. It was fun though.
How many times do you have to do the bulldog?
We won very slow again.
Oh, sorry. It was, how many times did you have to do that bulldog? This is where the big cut comes in. Just let me know when you can hear me.
Right.
Am I back?
And come back.
Cool. Right, cool. Right. What was I saying? How long did it, how, oh, yeah, so I was asking, how long did, how many times did you have to do the bulldog?
I think it was maybe like 5 or 6. We ran through it a couple of times before, and I had to shoot it through a couple of different angles. But it was like once I went through it, and because I had lip gloss on, my hair came out, and it wouldn't go back because it was stuck in my lip gloss. So I couldn't, like, I was like, nah, we're not going with that. I was like, okay, we'll just delete that one. That's not even going to be seen. The lighty day. But I've seen maybe like 7 or 8, actually.
So yeah, 6 or 7 elbow drops, and then I land on your arse 6 or 7 times. That's yeah. That doesn't sound like a fun day, but I mean, must have been. Must have been, because everyone looked like they were having a blast anyway, when I've seen all those things. Right, so thankfully there's only one more match to discuss, and then we can get to the questions, because it sounds like our internet is between us deciding to die. So we'll,
it does seem to be mine though. It does come up and see my internet's unstable.
Right. Okay. See, as a host, I don't want to blame my guests for their poor internet. So I was just trying to be diplomatic, but yeah, it probably is your problem that's it's going on. But yeah, so the match that'll happen,
I'll take the blame because it does come up on the screen, but
oh, mine's now come up with it. Your internet connection is unstable. So I'm assuming Kelly's downstairs watching something on Netflix or Disney Plus or something. That'll be her ruining my side of things. Trying to get Jack to fall asleep. So the one match I've got left. No, oh, missed that. What was that?
Wasn't it just my internet? See, I'm proof.
We'll split the blame. Split the blame like 60-40 year end. Right, so the last match I've got here is coming up next weekend, but it will be way past by the time that this episode goes out. It's in Tarbert, mm-hmm. which is yourself and Tommy Cartel against Johnny Lyons and Daisy Jenkins, which is a hell of a match to put it together. Tarbert, from what I've heard, is in the arse end of nowhere, but has a good passionate crowd. So
yeah, I've not heard much about the promotion, so getting to go somewhere new is fun, especially with like planning the match is going to be really good, because me and Daisy have wrestled each other like, god, I don't even care how many times, and I think me and Johnny Lyons have wrestled each other even more times than that. So I've also had a match with Tony Cartel as well, so I've wrestled them all, so it's going to be like really, I think it'll just be like an easy planning match. It'll just go so easy. Also got a really long card on me, so I'll have to listen to Johnny Lyons talk about cinemas and that for like 3 hours.
Oh, that'll be wonderful. You'll hate going to the cinema by the end of it. I love drawing lines. So that's all the matches stuff. That's our catch up of the year. One other note that I've got is, of course, we've got Twas the Night at the Wrestling coming up in December. Not much has been announced for that, so I can't really speak much about it. One other note is you were number two in our one to watch last year in the women's wrestling category. I mean, I don't know if you knew that at the time, but I don't know if you read that and went, oh, people are expecting things out of me next year. I better actually go do some things.
Yeah, I think it's just like, oh, people are actually wanting to see what I'm up to. That's kind of the main thing. I wasn't so nervous about like people expecting anything. I think it was just, it's like kind of, I'm going to watch whatever I do. It's just kind of, actually, it's just like, I was just really happy that I was even there.
Fair enough. Fair. Right. That's all our year of catch up. We've got loads of questions, so we'll just rattle through these a little bit. Well, again, as I said, while our internet's still living at both ends. So we've got Ashley Vega asking, fave Divas title reign.
I did see this comment and I thought about it for a while, but then when I realised, like, why am I thinking about this, it's Nikki Bella's.
Any in particular, or just Nikki Bella?
Nikki Bella's like sitting dream, and she was like the longest reign, and like her main reign. I think it was just, she bet absolutely everybody. She went through like every storyline. AJ Lee's, you know, last one towards Nikki was like close favourite. But I'm like a diehard Bella Twins fan, so it's like wasn't even a thought. I mean, I couldn't really say Brie Bella's because she had hers for like a week, so. Nikki Bella's, especially even towards the end, which came longer for him than Diva Champion. So.
Fair. Nikki Bella's going to be one of those people that are going to be, oh, I think she's getting it now. She's getting the respect she deserves, but too late. So folk are going back and going, she was actually pretty good. We hated her at the time because she was supposed to be this Divas thing, and she was plastered everywhere and put out for all the media stuff. It's like, there was a good reason. She was good at it. That was
like me. Like, I hated her for a while just because she was feuding with the Bella Twins. I was like, hate her, and then she retired. I was like, thank God she's gone. And then it was like a couple months, I was like, oh, I actually really miss her. And she was so, so good. Like, she would have been amazing, like, fitting in with like the women wrestling, like, nowadays. She was so ahead of time.
Absolutely. So, in our question, we've got, this is just from Twitter ones. We've got Ruby Roberts coming in with, If you had to pick one person from your fave TV show to tag with, who would it be and why?
I also have to think about this because I've got a few favourites. So my main favourite right now is Only Murders in the Building, which is on Disney+.
Oh, nice. Yes.
So yep. It would be Mabel, for that, which I'm really happy with because she tackled somebody in it. And you know, she was also on trial for murder, so it's like kind of winning. Also, The Big Bang Theory, which I'll take Penny. She's been a fan. She's dealt with animals, so she can get the job done. That's what I'm going to go with. But I'll go with Mabel, the Only Murders in the Building.
Very good. Yeah, I really enjoyed Only Murders in the Building, and it's just, yeah, it was so much fun. I mean, anything you can get Steve Martin and Martin Short in, you're pretty much on to a winner anyway. But Selena Gomez was certainly a highlight in those two seasons. Mm-hmm. And I'm very excited for season three. I don't know if that'd be spoilers for anyone. There's going to be someone that's going to be in season three that just is a vampire. And I can't wait for them to see them in season three and see what happens. Right. No, I won't get into Only Murders. We'll end speaking about that for now. Right. So back to Instagram. We got, like I said, loads of questions from Megan, but we'll go with the other ones. We've got Dudes at Ringside podcast. I don't know if you've done Dudes at Ringside yet.
I've not done it yet, Matt.
No, it will be an experience when you do it, for sure. lovely guys. It's a bit, if you think my show's kind of was scattered in that, Dudes at Ringside is another, there's just thoughts come in and then it goes into different directions. You don't know what's going to happen on that show.
It's fine. That's how my brain works anyway. It's like, we talk about one thing and then I'll realise like a different story that kind of relates to it, but Disney, and then I'll talk about that and it just kind of goes until I find my way back to the original point.
Yeah, that's you're going to get on with Joe the Panther. That he is exactly that. I was booked for it, and I was going to speak about obviously the podcast and try and plug that. But WrestleMania happened that weekend, So I went on to try and speak about my podcast, and we spoke for an hour about two nights of WrestleMania, and I didn't actually mention that I had a podcast in the end of it. So I was like, I have not done what I've come to do here. We've just spoken about WrestleMania for an hour instead. Anyway, lovely guys. He's asked, is there anywhere else in the world you would like to wrestle, and where would that be?
I would also like to wrestle in America. I would like to go down to England to eventually wrestle. I've always wanted to wrestle in Japan. I've wrestled masses over there, but then I was like, Japanese wrestlers are very hard hitting. Do I want to lose a tooth? Probably not. But I think the experience of wrestling in Japan would be amazing, because everybody you speak to that's been a Japan wrestler, they've always said it's like the best experience they've ever had. So I will say Japan as well.
Great. And so we'll go for Judas Gray next. He's put, how was the first Truth show? Kind of discussed a little bit, but how was the first Truth show, the crowd, the whole show, the matches? And then he's also added, so basically insert general questions about the Truth show and the shameless Judas plug. Have you met Judas Gray? Have I frozen at your end?
Oh no, it's breaking up again.
So Judas Gray's asked the question. Have you had the pleasure of meeting Judas Gray?
I'm getting there. I'm kind of hearing your questions.
Okay. I'm keeping all this in. I'm not editing out. Cool, right. Judas Gray. Now he's not mentioned three times. Have you met him?
Yes.
Has he told you about DMG?
No.
Do you know what DMG is?
No.
I'm not going to tell you. It's fine. Anyone who doesn't know at this point what DMG is, go check his episode of our podcast, because it is fascinating and also disturbing at the same time. Anyway, he's put, how was the first Truth show, the crowd, the whole show, the matches, and then put, so basically insert general questions about the Truth show and then the shameless Judas plug. So he just wanted his name mentioned a lot.
Yeah.
General, how was the first Truth show?
Great. It was amazing. I've already said like the whole thing was great. Even planning the match was like really great. But so me and Daisy Jenkins were there a couple hours before kind of hit, so when I got there a bit was set up anyway, but just kinda so we could plan. But Izzy was coming up to England, so she was coming at about 5 o'clock, doors were opening at 6. Ashley Vega was working, so she working. She was the manager of that one. But she was coming at about 5:30, so we were like stressing it. We were on second. We were like, we're not gonna have long, like, because I had to also do like the mini meet and greet, like welcome in and the VIP guest at the start, so I had to be away for like 6, 5:30-ish. So we were really stressed, but then the match went really well. I did get hit with a bat, which was fine. But it was good. It was good that even the plan in the match, me and Daisy kind of go like that. We'll just plan all this, and we'll leave gaps where they can have whatever creative freedom they want. And the match came out really good. Like even after the match, Andy kind of came back and said like, "Oh, like, I think it was his father-in-law. He says the match was really good. He doesn't care about wrestling, so if you can get him interested, then you've done a good job." Which I think made me really proud, because it was me and Daisy. We were both still trainees.
Mm-hmm.
On this match that somebody who doesn't care about wrestling is interested in. So I think it just shows like our improvement, and also the fact that we've worked together so many times and planned so many matches, it's like just helps.
Excellent. So Judas Gray, that's your question answered, Judas.
There you go
Judas. So we've got the wonderfully title named on Instagram, Cockapoo underscore Charlie, asking, what is your favorite wrestling stage of shows you've done? So I don't know if that means wrestling matches or of the shows that you've done, or I don't understand the question. Or what's your favorite wrestling stage of shows you've done? So
I didn't even
come
what that means.
Yeah, no, me neither. We'll go with match. We'll go match. I'll just say that. So sorry, Charlie. if you want to direct your question directly to Harmony to explain.
Yeah, just
do that. But what's your favorite? What's some of your favorite matches so far?
I would say one of my favorite matches was my match with Anastasia, which was at ICW. I just because I'd improved so much the last time I went. So just seeing the improvement and also getting to watch it on WWE Network, which is like one of my favourites. We'll also go with the CPW one. I think it was just getting me and Daisy, because like we're for the same school, and we're getting to go up to Glasgow to play this match. It was great, and obviously we'll go with the Fatal 4-Way at Truth, which is a nice one. Bo Dadler was up there, but I got the Truth.
Well, your match with Brody is on YouTube for anyone wanting to check it out. It's on FCW Empire. So you can check that out. So we're finishing off then. We've got Megan's rest of her questions. they're all quite nice ones that we've got here. So someone in your school to watch out for?
I will say Redfield, because they work so hard. And it's crazy. You wouldn't even believe what they used to be like when he first started. Like, he'd hit you and he'd instantly apologise. Because if you'd sell it, he'd hit you with genuine hurt. He'd say, I'm sorry. And then he'd, like, disappear. And, like, just his improvement is just unbelievable. And the character he's got and just everything. And also, I will say Lexi Campbell as well. They train really hard. I mean, they're only 15. So they've I used to train with them at previous school. So we were in the same class. And then I ended up helping teaching them at the juniors for a bit. And now they're like an adult class. So it's really weird. And we talk all the time. They're always kind of like showing me what kind of gears they've got, kind of like gear ideas, or they send me, so they do drag, which I love drag race and all that. So it's like they'll send me kind of, oh, I want to do this kind of competition or things. And I think they're, and it's great because you didn't really ken how many drag wrestlers do you really know? Well, me, I don't really know any, so I say watch it for Lexi Kimball.
Excellent. So speaking of gear, we've also got any new gear soon?
Yeah. Well, it's not made, but I've got a couple of ideas, and I will, it's similar, but it's shorts this time, is what I'll say.
All right, so we teaser there for folk.
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere you'd like to return to wrestle?
I'd like to go back to FCW. The crowd there were great as well. They were just chanting, like, they had no idea who I was. So they were just chanting anyway, which was just, like, great. And I would also like to go back to ICW eventually, just because, like, their crowd. I've been to ICW twice, but I've only wrestled in front of the crowd once. And I think I'm more confident in my wrestling now than even I was, like, last December, which is when I had my match there. You never know. Maybe, like, even wrestling, like, because Daisy's in at ICW a lot now, like, imagine us like come going through wrestling each other, training to wrestling each other in WWE Network, which would be like a really proud moment, I think.
Excellent. And to finish up this annual catch up, we've got Megan's final question. Just make sure it is not missed one. What do you hope to achieve in the next year?
I would really like to just get more matches, kind of also work on myself, work on my physique, work on kind of just getting back into where I was. Which I kind of come to the realisation that it's fine to kind of miss training sometimes. You know, like obviously getting money and you want to go, but sometimes you just can't. So I think it's fine, like I'm fine missing some training sessions to focus on myself. Also, just to get kind of more confident, focus on the mental health side, because that's a daily struggle. It's not just like obviously wrestling wise, daily struggles and things. So focus on that, just get me matches, kind of go back to companies that are already aware of me, like FCW and things, because that, like, I worked with wrestling FCW for ages, so when I finally like got the message about it, I was like, yeah, I didn't even care who I was fighting until like not that long before. I was like, yeah, I'll go. So just kind of new matches, hopefully new gear as well, and hopefully be on Made of the Patrick shows, because that was like one of my favourites.
Excellent. We'll find out probably next year when we catch up again.
Find it next year.
Exactly. But otherwise, how can people find, if they want to find out beforehand, they don't want to hear from myself in 12 months' time, where can people find out more about Harmony Skye?
I'm on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, and I'm sure they're all Harmony Skye _03 or Harmony Skye 03, like all together. I'm sure.
Excellent. Nice and easy. Well, thank you very much for
Thank you.
catching up with us again. And like I say, 12 months' time, we'll see what happens, and we'll get part four in the books. But in the meantime,
I'll have better decorations for Halloween time next year.
Hopefully, between the two of us, we'll have better internet.
Yes, probably not though.
No, probably. Yeah, I mean, if I'm going back to the office, I'm going to have to do all my ancient laptop anyway, so we'll just have to hope and a prayer that it works. But no, this has been an absolute blast. It's amazing to see your growth against, like I say, from your first episode to now. It's just it's like seeing your evolution, and it always makes me proud because seeing these people come back on the show, there's been absolute different people, just so much more confident. Haven't yet had someone go from really confident to coming back on being really timid and shy. There's still time. There's still time for that to happen, but hopefully it won't. But no, it's been an absolute blast. Thank you very much for taking time to speak to me again.
Thank you.